Welcome to Lesson 5, Networking and Content Delivery. This lesson covers the three fundamental Amazon Web Services for networking and content delivery. Amazon Virtual Private Cloud, Amazon VPC, and Amazon Cloud Front. In this lesson, we are going to start by looking into networking basics, and then we will discuss Amazon VPC, why we need them, and how we can create them. Then we will discuss the VPC security and how Amazon Route 53 is going to work and provide us with high availability across multiple regions. Then we will discuss the CloudFront content delivery, and I will show you how to create a VPC like a pro, and I will ask you to do one lab, which is building your VPC and launch a web server. And we have an activity to do together, which is designing your first VPC. In the classical networking, we normally have each group of PCs grouped into local area network or a LAN. Each LAN has its own unique address in the network to make the communication between multiple PCs possible, similar to the internet. So here in this diagram, we have a subnet 1 and subnet 2. And let's say PC A wants to communicate with PC C in the same network. For example, if PC 1 wants to communicate with PC C in the same network, it needs to know the address of the PC C so it will receive the message and not PC B. So that we use in computer networking an address schema called IP address. As you can see, each computer in subnet 1 and 2 has a unique identifier as an IP. Now, when PC A wants to send a message to computer C, he will address it to PC C using its IP 10.0.0.3, and he will include his own IP address if PC C wants to reply to PC A the message. Now, what will happen if PC A wants to send a message to another computer in another subnet? Let's say subnet 2 is in another country. In this case, the message will be routed via the internet gateway, which routes the message from one network to another. However, when those messages travel between subnets and network, they need a public identity in order to be delivered successfully to their destination. In this case, an internet gateway put his identity in the message that is coming from subnet 1 and delivered the message to the computer in subnet 2. When computer BCD in the second subnet wants to reply to the message, he uses the internet gateway IP to deliver the message. Then the internet gateway changes the destination address from his own IP to the PCA private IP. This is how network communication works. So we agree that each client machine in a network must have a unique internet to protocol address that identifies it. An IP address is a numerical label in decimal format. Machines convert that decimal number to a binary format. In this example, the IP address 192.0.2.0, each of the four dots separated numbers of the IP address represent 8 bits. That means each of the four numbers can be anything from 0 to 255. The combined total of the four numbers for an IP address is 32 bits in binary format. A 32-bit IP address is called an IPv4 address. And IPv6 addresses, which are 128 bits, are also available. And IPv6 addresses can accommodate more user devices. The reason why IPv6 was invented at the first place is to give any device in the universe a public IP because it has a huge number of available IP equals to 2 to the power 128. If you check that number in the calculator, you will see how large this number is. In fact, it enables us to give every square centimeter in Earth a unique IPv6 address. Because we do not have enough IP in the IPv4 scheme, we have to do two things to have enough IPv4 addresses for the total number of computers available on the internet. First, we use some IPs as a private address in the local area network, and we use some IPv4 addresses as a public IP to carry a message between computers in the internet. Second, we start to use a classless entire domain routing, a CIDR, as we will see in the next class. In CIDR notation, we take the subnet IP and we divide it into two parts. One part used mainly for the network, and the second part we use it for the host. See, in this example, we have a digits allocated for host, which means we can have up to 255 different PCs in this particular subnet. From where we got the 255? Count how many digits we have in the example allocated to the host part. We have 8 digits, so we can get 2 to the power 8, which is 256. In this network, there is two IPs reserved. The first one is the network ID, which is 192.0.2.0. This IP is the identifier of the whole network, and we can't use it for an end device or as an IP for a computer in the network. And the second IP is the broadcast IP, which is the IP 192.0.2.255, which means any computer belongs to this subnet, he can communicate with every other computer using that broadcast IP. So let us take another example to understand the CIDR better. In this example, we have a subnet ID 10.0.0.0 with a slash 16. This means we have a 16 bits locked for the network and another 16 locked for the host. Now, each digit of those 16 could have the value 0 or 1. This means we can get two possible numbers from each digit, whether 0 or 1. But we have 16 digits of those in total, so the total number of IPs in this subnet will be equal to 2 to the power 16. Hopefully this is clear to you guys. I will be grateful if you like this video and leave a comment if you have any question about the CIDR notation, because it is very important to understand VPC, and a VPC understanding is vital and important to pass your certification exam. We agreed that an AWS is a data center which contains many resources, including your applications, database, email server, and a S3 bucket where you keep your more precious data. All of those resources need to speak with the internet, and for this, we have something called a VPC, a virtual private cloud, which allows you to create a logical isolated section of the AWS cloud and to put your resources and your precious data services inside your own VPC. Is it clear, guys? If not, you know what to do. Leave a comment down below and I will do my best to address your concern. In AWS, VPC gives you full control over networking and which IP address you could use, and you are able to create more subnets of the VPC, and you can put your resources in those isolated segments of your VPC, and we call those segments a subnet. So we understand that a VPC is a logical isolated segment of AWS cloud that you have full control over it. But why? So imagine this scenario. We have an AWS cloud and we are in the EU West 1, the Irish region. Each region is divided into 3 availability zones. In fact, the Irish region has only a 3 availability zone. Now, we want to create our own segment of that AWS cloud inside the Irish region. So we will create our VPC, and this VPC will be dedicated to our AWS account, and it will also belong to that region, and this spans over the 3 availability zones. And you can now divide your VPC into smaller segments or subnets. In this case, each subnet will be associated with 1 availability zone. Each subnet can be classified as a public or a private subnet based on the type of resources you are planning to put in it. Normally, web servers are public-facing resource, so they will be placed on a public subnet to enable end user to access them. However, services like database, backend services, email servers, or application server, it is recommended to keep them in a private subnet. When you create your VPC, you will assign to it a CIDR block and this network address you cannot change later. The largest block is /16 and the smallest block is /28 in the VPC in the AWS management console. A /16 address can be used to give us a 65,536 addresses maximum. But a /28 is going to give us a 16 addresses only. However, it is recommended to keep your VPC large enough to accommodate future growth of your services and products. When you create a VPC similar with a CIDR block, 10.0.0/16, it has a total IP addresses of 65,536, which calculated as 2 to the power 16. Dividing this VPC into 4 equally sized subnets with a CIDR /24 will make each subnet contains a 256 IP address. Now, in AWS, and to make VPC networking work, there is 5 IP reserved for the use of AWS infrastructure. The first one is reserved for the networking address, the second one for the internal communication, and the third is used by domain name system, which is a service we use as a phone book in your mobile phone. A phone book matches name into telephone number. Similarly, DNS matches a domain like Amazon.com to the public IP of Amazon.com server. A route table contains a set of rules called routes that directs network traffic from your subnet. Each route specifies a destination and a target. The destination is the destination of the CIDR block where you want your traffic from your subnet to go to. The target is the target that the destination traffic is sent through. By default, every route table that you create contains a local route for communication inside the VPC. You can customize route table by adding routes. You cannot delete the local route entry that is used for internal communication. So the summary of this class, a VPC is a logically isolated section of the AWS cloud. A VPC belongs to one region and requires a CIDR block. A VPC is subdivided into subnet. A subnet belongs to an availability zone and requires a CIDR block. Route table control traffic for a subnet and route table have a built-in local route. You add an additional route to the table and the local route cannot be deleted. In the next class, guys, we are going to discuss how we create a VPC, how we create a private subnet and a public subnet. Thank you for seeing this video and see you in the next one.